And the numbers are so, you know, so astronomically high. If you and I, and we got a couple partners and wanted to find some land and say, hey, let's open up the Dialysis Center, it will be full before we put that last brick in the wall. It will be full of patients. When we open up, we'll be full. That is the need. Because of our diet, lack of exercise, there's a lot of things. You know, we have this pandemic going on, and, you know, I'm always trying to stay abreast of what's going on in the health community. And when I read that how this pandemic and this virus is affecting the African-American community, some say it's health disparities, and me, I say it's life disparities. You know, there are things that we are not privy to, lack of health care, lack of financial well-being, a lot of those things. That's the same thing when you talk about organ donation and transplantation. The reason why a lot of our folks are on dialysis and need transplant is lack of health care, lack of diet, poor diet. We got food deserts that are all over the place. We don't have adequate health care. Those are things that prevent us from going to the doctor. Then when we do go, our organs are failed and we have to start dialysis. Dialysis, fortunately, is funded by the federal government and state government. So you'll get the treatment if you have kidney failure. And here in this state, you're considered disabled when you have kidney failure. So you'll get the support and you'll get money to sustain your family because you'll either get Medicare or Social Security income. But we don't need all of our people on dialysis. I think if we change what we're doing and we do things a little differently, you know, I get the opportunity to speak with a lot of churches and speak at a lot of churches. And I'm always so curious. Now, I ask the question to a lot of pastors and faith leaders, why is it when there's food in the church, it's always fried chicken? I can give you the menu. The church you go to, I can give you the menu. It's fried chicken.
Mac and cheese.
Mac and cheese. It'll be some kind of rice pilaf. You're going to have green beans, a roll, peach cobbler, and sweet tea.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
So my theory is when you give people free food, they're going to eat it. So if we change that concept instead of frying everything, what about bacon chicken, grilling chicken? What about turkey? What about different things that are a little bit more healthier? And I'm a firm believer in our community. It's been going on before I was here, and it's going to probably be going on. We get a lot of our information and guidance from our pastors and from churches. So if we change in the churches, then people will change. I'm just a firm believer, and I say that to every church that I go to. And I've gotten some churches to change where they say, Bobby, you know what? We don't fry anything in here anymore. And the folks, you know, just are doing things differently. And we have to start doing those things differently. And it's a mindset and it's a cultural change. I'm not from the South, from the Northeast. And so the things that I grew up on eating and when I first moved in the South, I had to adjust. And now I love fried chicken. I love fried chicken. But I have to eat it in moderation.
Yes. Yes. That's a difficult thing to overcome because, like you said, it's deeply rooted in the culture.
Yes.
It is, you know, it's almost an insult if you don't, you know, especially if you, you know, start talking about not eating, you know, mama's fried chicken. You know, you're playing with your life now.
And you're changing. You're changing the mindset and just a lot of things. I mean, even now, children with diabetes at 5 and 6 years old, that was never heard of. Right. And there are things that we could change as people. And there's so many things about being healthy, being fit, and just walking. You know, I'm always sharing with folks when I speak is that it's interesting, you know, you look at, you know, you think you can be in the car with someone and folks would drive around the parking lot till they find that prime parking spot that's in front. Why we always got to park in front? Why can't we park in back when we walk that same
and walk?
When we have
and
more
get
water.
Exercise.
When we drink more water, it flushes the system. You know, I have this running thing with ranch dressing. you know, with ranch dressing. And I don't, I'm not a ranch dressing or mayonnaise-y kind of person, so I'm a vinaigrette or an Italian. And I, you know, with some of my friends and go out to things, I said, just look at these trends. I said, when I go to a function that's primarily African-American, there's always ranch and blue cheese. I can never find Italian or vinaigrette. But when I go to a Caucasian function, they got vinaigrette and Italian. And it's oil-based instead of all these things. Yeah. So I tell some of my friends, I said, what would ever happen if they stopped making Hidden Valley Ranch? What will we do?
Mutiny.
You know, so I mean, you know, those are the things. And so, you know, so my drive and my passion, it's about health. It's about having a healthy heart. And I know, you know, after I got out of the league and my kidneys failed, and they were telling me, you know, it was hereditary and those kind of things. And I didn't believe it at first, but now because I have some other nieces and nephews who are on dialysis and who received transplants, I sort of believe it now. But it's a challenge to be healthy. And it's, you know, I work very hard to be where I am weight-wise. When I played football, I was 230 pounds and I played. Today, I weigh like 224. So I'm under my plan weight when I played football. But I work very hard to do that, and I have to be disciplined to do that. And I just, my dream and my hope is that as people, that we change and stop doing the things that we've always done. If we change, I think we'll have better results. We will enjoy life a lot better than what is foreseeable that we're enjoying the way we're enjoying life now.
That conversation in between the ears.
Yes.
And as you said, that mindset, that conversation, and having to change that conversation and stick to that change. It's different.
And you know what else, apology is that we have to do a better job of reaching back and taking some of our young people along with us.
Yeah,
you know, for so long I coached high school football here at several high schools in the Metro Atlanta area, and I have kids that I coached 20 years ago. Coach Howard, they call me. We stay up to date, and I'm a firm believer. If we all just grab one, just one. If you can get more than one, that's great. But if you just grab one, and say, "Hey, young man, hey, young lady, you're not doing this the right way." It doesn't matter if they got mother, father, auntie, big mama at home. It doesn't matter. Grab one. And it shouldn't matter who we have at home either. Because for all of us to be successful as adults, we all had someone who grabbed us when we were younger. So if we just grab one.
Yes.
And we teach them the ways, then they can teach. And it becomes a continuum. But we're not grabbing one. Some of us are grabbing one. Some of us are saying, well, that's their issue. And I struggle with that because I say, well, you didn't get to where you were by yourself.
By yourself. That's right. And when you grab one, you know, I always say it with mentorship, when you grab one, it's a lifetime commitment, because when that young man or that young lady begins to trust you, you invest in them. It's a lifelong commitment, even into adult. Like you said, players that you coached years ago are probably parents themselves now. It's a couple of them, maybe parents. Yeah. Not date yourself, but they're parents.
I have no shame, and I told you this. I will be 56 on June 1st. I am so proud, because a lot of folks didn't think I would get this far. Proud to be where I am. I am proud to tell folks I am 56. There's a lot of guys I grew up with. They didn't make it this far. So I am blessed and proud and happy. I want to tell you this quick thing about when you say mentorship. There was a kid that I coached. And when I say he was probably the worst football player I ever coached in my years of high school playing. But what he did, he showed up to every single practice. Whatever I said, do, this kid did it. He was just awful. I couldn't remember this kid's name. I just knew he had big ears. So I gave him the nickname Ears. So in during his senior year, I said, I'm going to get you in a game. I said, trust me, I will find something for you to do. Put him in a couple games. He played, happy as kid. Fast forward to probably about 8 years ago, I'm walking in Lenox Mall, and I hear someone say, hey, coach, and I saw this grown man just running. So, of course, nobody's talking to me. I just moved to the side. Go on past. Guy stopped. He said, Coach Howard, you don't remember me? And I was like, no. He took his hat off, and those ears popped out. I said, ears. And he said, Coach. He said, Coach. Oh, Coach, you got to meet my wife. You got to meet my wife. So this lady comes with a stroller, had, you know, two little kids on each side and still pushing the stroller. She said, he said, honey, he said, this is the coach I told you about. He said, Coach, I just want to tell you, you never kicked me off the team. I know I wasn't any good, but you helped me play. He said, I want to tell you, I'm getting ready to get my PhD.
See that?
This kid calls me every month. He said, Coach, I've been looking for you. And I tell folks, you never know what impact you're going to have on anyone's life. And but like I said, the kid came and I was teaching and teaching. He just, football just wasn't his game, but he needed to be around. He needed to be in that environment.
And he remembered that. Isn't that something?
Yes.
What were you feeling in your heart, in your soul, when he came up and just started pouring out to you and telling his wife, "This is who I was talking about." How did your heart feel?
Look, I was so happy, and I was like, wow. I mean, I really wanted to stand there and cry. I was like, wow, you know, you make, and I said, I'm making an impact. And I didn't think, you know, you're coaching football, you want everybody to win. And this kid, he changed my whole perspective of how I started, start looking at coaching. Now there's some kids, you know, and I can't touch all of them, but I got kids calling me, Coach, I'm doing this. My mother and father told me to call you before I made a decision. I mean, that much influence you can have in a young person's life to help guide them. And they're having children and telling them, hey, remember I told you, this was the coach who coached me. You know, he told me this. I mean, there's guys even that I coach who played in the NFL that are in my chapter. They're always telling me, oh, this was my coach. That's my coach right there. That's Coach Howard. I mean, so I always say it's that gift that keeps on giving, you know. And we have a gift as people. Mentorship, just being alive is a gift.
It truly is.
And we share that gift and we're able to bless others, man, it's an awesome feeling to just be able to see others that you have touched or been a part of their lives and just see them transform into something and you can stand there and be proud and say, wow, I had a hand in helping that young man and a hand in helping that young lady grow to be the person that they are today.
Yes, and that is such a gift. That is such a blessing. And you have shared so much with us. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, and I know I ramble a lot, and I do want to apologize to your listening audience. I am just so passionate about life. I'm passionate about people. I'm just passionate about us living our best lives and getting everything we can out of life because we only get one shot at this.
That's it. That's
we only
it.
Get
we
one
don't
shot.
Get another.
Yeah, you don't
yes,
get a duo.
We don't get another round, and this has been a wonderful. This has been a wonderful ramble. I'll say that it's been a wonderful ramble. It's been a great conversation because you have shared, and that's what this show is about: having guests come on and share what it is that they're passionate about, share what it is that feeds their soul. You know, you may have heard me say at the top of the show, time is precious.
Mm-hmm.
It's the one thing that you cannot get back. So for those who choose to spend an hour listening to this show, I want them to hear passion. You know, I want them to hear the love of what it is that you're doing with this life that we have given. And we're only given one. You know, what we're doing with this life that we're given, and also how that conversation, I always say this, the conversation in between our ears affects what it is that we do each and every day, you know, with our lives and how we pour into others. So I thank you. No apologies necessary at all. I thank you so much because I know that you have enlightened, you have encouraged the listeners that are listening.